Hi, it's Larry here from Xbox Live's Major Nelson. Thank you for downloading the show. Jeff, good to see you.
It's good to see you too, Larry.
Sitting across from you is an empty microphone. Laura is out of the office again. And you know what that means?
We're playing hooky? Or we're going to be off the rails?
No.
What?
It means Albert's here.
Yes. We've never seen you two in the same place.
No, we did. Actually, last time, right. It has been confirmed after many years that we are not the same person because we were in the same place at the same time.
Yeah, we did one show.
This goes back to the tradition of every time I'm on the show, she just decides to.
Well, it's funny because when I was talking to him, I'm like, hey, Albert, can you come on the show? Because we're going to talk about some Scorpio stuff. We'll do that in a little bit.
Never heard of it.
But I looked at the schedule like, oh, yeah, of course Laura's gone. Thanks.
So. Did I do something? I've been so nice to her.
I know. We great, all have.
But
she's a tough read.
She bails every time I'm on the show.
She's a tough read. But anyway,
I take it personally.
It's great to see you. You are the director of Scorpio Marketing.
Senior director.
Senior.
Come on.
I know, sorry.
King, Lord of all
I
survey.
You know how I know it's senior? Because of the gray hair.
That's really? From this crew.
Anyway, the show, I got Albert on the show because we had some news this week, depending upon when you're listening to this, that just recently broke about Scorpio, and you were involved with that, and I wanted to kind of get you on because I read the story over at Digital Foundry, mm-hmm. watched the video, yeah. and I'm not the smartest person in the world. God,
yes,
the technology that's in that video and what was going over, I felt like I was in an electrical engineering class. I stumbled into the wrong room.
That being said, the article is called Scorpio is Console Hardware Pushed to a New Level, and you should read it. Even if you're not going to understand every spec, which is why we've got you here, it is well worth
actually,
reading.
Actually, we're going to be talking about this. He also has a great sort of article just for like, what does it mean for if you're not technically savvy?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's also really
Scorpio
excellent.
Made simple.
Scorpio
yes.
made simple.
I'll link
really
to all
excellent.
Of those in the show notes.
But anyway, normally we do the show, we talk about what we're playing and have some interviews, but I figured, you know, this is the first time, frankly, since E3 last year, where we said, okay, we'll talk about Scorpio.
Yeah, it was... yeah,
so let's do that.
Yeah, we were joking before. What game have I been playing? The game I've been playing is getting ready to tell everyone about Scorpio.
Yeah.
It is funny because we have said very little since E3 last year.
Yeah.
And I kind of joked that we announced, like, we said three numbers.
Right.
We said 6 teraflops and 8 cores and 320 gigabytes and the most powerful console ever, and then nothing.
Well,
really.
We kind of said 4 if you want to count 2017.
Okay, and 2017, yeah, coming next year.
Right.
So, you know, people thought it was crazy to announce a new console at the beginning of the show and then announce another new console at the end of the show.
But we did it.
But we did it, and, you know, the anticipation and the reaction was great. And, of course, inside, you just want to, like, tell everybody everything right away.
Yeah. Now, so, I must tell a personal story. I'm sorry to cut you off, which is what I do in the show. Is, you know, Albert, I've known you a long time. You and I have been working on the Xbox business for a long time. And I stop by your office frequently. Like, hey, what's going on? And you kind of tell me what this is the plans for the next thing, you know, in this case, Scorpio. So you and I have been chatting about this for quite some time.
Quite some time, yes.
And
right.
So I was so excited, obviously, when we announced it last year, and even more excited because we're sharing more details.
Yeah. I mean, the idea was, you know, when we announced the specs last year, we made a claim, like we stuck our flag, as it were, and said we're going to build the most powerful console ever, and we're going to deliver 4K games. And it was interesting because people, you know, they question things like that.
Yeah.
Are you really going to be able to do it? And I don't understand. And I knew that we not only were going to deliver it, I believe we would exceed it. And
yeah.
What's been great about today is that I think we've been able to prove definitively with an outlet that is known for being very savvy and being very technically focused.
Yeah.
We've been able to sort of tell the story that, yeah, we're going to do exactly what we said we can do and better.
Let's talk about that for a second, because I saw some people online going, wait a minute, why would you do, why would you just not do an event? Why Digital Foundry? So tell me a little bit about why the decision to go with or to talk to Digital Foundry. I mean, they're well respected. As I always like to say, they're the pixel counters on the internet.
Yeah, look, I mean, here's the thing. The launch has been unorthodox, and I mean that in a great way. Like, we are doing things unexpected. Announcing a year early was unexpected.
Never happened before.
Typically, people think, oh, they're going to do a big reveal event, and they're going to parade people out on stage. And we said, no, like, this product is for core gamers.
Yeah.
This product is a technical achievement and beyond just a bunch of numbers on a page. And really, like, the guy, Richard, and the guys at DF, that's what they do. They're an unbiased, well-respected source. They're very knowledgeable. There's nobody like them. And we thought, you know what? Why? If I go out and I tell the specs, and if anybody follows NeoGAF, they'll laugh at that. But if I go out and talk about it, you know, then people are just going to say, well, I'll just wait for Digital Foundry.
Well, that's just Albert. Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
Exactly. And so I'm like, well, why don't we just go to Digital Foundry?
Yeah.
then you don't have to wait.
It's cut to the chase.
So yeah, I don't want to say bold decision, but I think it was an out of the box decision. And for what we were trying to do, I think it was a good one.
And let's be clear, it was a bold decision because my understanding is you invited Richard Ledbetter from Digital Foundry to come in here. And we showed him everything. We didn't know. And this is an honest to God true story. We did not know until the morning that article went up what he was going to say, right?
100%. In fact, you prepare for something like
sure.
this. We read his stuff. I read his stuff. Your listeners read his stuff.
Yeah.
You know what he's been thinking. You know what he's been saying. So we had a good idea that we were going to exceed his expectations because we knew what his expectations were.
Sure.
So you plan, you have a day prepared. You want to, you know what questions he's going to ask.
You studied for the test.
We studied, but more than that, it's like, we built a great product. I mean, the people that have been reading the reviews, they know that we're building a great product. And so we were going to let the product speak for itself.
Yep.
And we were going to have an expert come in. And the fact is I was up at 5:40. I was up at 5:15.
So was I.
I was here at 5:56 with the crew, with hit and refresh on my browser, just like anyone else. Because again, when you do that, it's like the movie business, you make your movie and you put it out and you're waiting for the reviews to come in.
Yeah,
right? You're waiting for what the feedback is.
Can we back up a little bit? All three of us, I know, have read this article. But for those who are listening here now and haven't read the article, what did you show Richard?
Yeah, let's go through what he saw and kind of, because I know certainly he wrote a lot. He did some videos. He wrote a lot of words about it. But tell us about it.
Yeah, well, I think we were really focused on the tech. So one of the pieces of feedback I'll just start with is like, hey, they didn't show or announce any games. They didn't announce a date or a price. And like we all knew from going in, that wasn't what the goal of. There are other events, maybe some events that happen, in the summertime and later in the year.
In Los Angeles, perhaps,
where things like that happen. But we knew that people were going to have questions about these numbers
right.
and about what we were doing. So we wanted to bring the foremost expert in to do that. And so this was a tech, spec, and hardware unveil.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't intended to be a game unveil. We did show him some engine demos of Forza Tech. We took him to Turn 10.
Yeah, he talked about that in the video.
And he talked about in the video. Yeah. So because we knew we needed to punctuate this with content.
Yeah.
We needed him to see something running to validate the claims. Mm-hmm. And so he did, but it wasn't a game reveal. It was a tech and hardware reveal. So what we basically did is we brought him in and Mike Ibarra and myself just gave him a little bit of background on Project Scorpio and what our goals were. We kind of told him, hey, we want to get our mojo back. We want to be the platform where the best games are played on Xbox.
Yep.
That was our drive.
That's
the goal. And we wanted to hit four things. We wanted to own 4K. We really wanted to hit a big beat around 4K. We wanted to be a great platform for developers.
Yep.
And I think people will hear maybe more news around our developer story. We have a really awesome developer story.
Yeah.
We wanted to be excellent for people who have 1080p TVs. And we could talk a little bit about the fact that not everybody is going to have 4K this mm-hmm. year. And it needed to be a great Xbox,
mm-hmm.
even if you don't have 4K, and that that everything needed to work, and all the effort and energy we put into compatibility and upgradability and things like that. So those are the four things we wanted to take him through, and we just spent the day, taking him through all those areas.
We heard a lot, or we saw a lot in the video, and we've seen some chatter online afterwards about the Scorpio engine.
Yes.
Explain, I want to kind of, if we can go through his article and maybe talk about some of the things and bring them down to something I can understand.
Yeah, well, frankly, or something I can understand too, because I still sit, I've been doing this for years and I still sit in awe.
These electrical engineers.
Kevin and talk about the software and the hardware.
But I would like to point out that you do have an honorary pocket protector. So you are kind of a nerd.
They let me in the club.
Yeah.
Right? I'm the class clown. It's like, you can come in. Yeah. That guy's cool. Let him in.
Exactly.
But so no, I've been working with those guys for a long time. So I understand, but still like the passion and the deep depth and history of game development and hardware development.
From the Silicon point of view.
Yeah, from Silicon and Andrew from graphics and Kevin, Gamble from the platform perspective. These guys are
wicked smart.
Yeah.
But no, like, I think your question was explaining it.
The engine.
The Scorpio engine.
Well, so, more about the engine, but more about explaining what we saw.
Well, there was two things. First off is when we announced Project Scorpio, you know, it's a cool name. And the Scorpio engine was really the sort of thing we're talking about.
You know that the internet wants that to be the final name.
I know the internet wants that to be the final name.
It's already got an emoticon.
Well, and it's now, it is part of the final product in the Scorpio engine. That's, that will be where Scorpio continues on into the product. That's, that's where that sort of the beating heart of the product is the Scorpio engine. The other thing I like about it is, it is very easy, and I see this frequently, for people to think that building a console is like building a PC. That I just I just call up AMD and I say, give me that CPU and give me that GPU.
You go to partpicker.com.
You know, it's like AMD's got a Fry's electronic shop that we just go pick at, you know, for those in the West Coast that know Fry's.
Yeah.
And then that's it. That's how you make a console. And it's so much more than that.
Talk to us about that.
It's so much more complicated. Well, we, you know, we, AMD is a great partner for ours. AMD has IP. They have technology.
Mm-hmm.
We have IP and technology. We work with them to scope the objectives and goals of the project. So there is AMD IP and there's Microsoft IP in these things, and we work together to build the Scorpio engine.
Mm-hmm.
It is not just simply a, you know, Radeon graphics chip and a Jaguar core that we've sort of just glued together. It's way more complicated than that. Again, a reason why a guy like Richard Ledbetter is perfect to tell that story. Mm-hmm. So we wanted to sort of talk about all the customizations because the Scorpio engine is something unique, and it's something that we're super proud of.
Should I think of it, you know, should people think of the Scorpio engine as like, this is the graphics engine, or this is the game engine, this is the sound, what is it, all of those?
Well, that's the thing about a game console, is you have what's called a system on a chip,
yeah,
a SoC.
SoC,
you'll see an SoC, which is the memory controller and the CPU and the GPU and the audio processing blocks and all of the command processors are all in one thing.
Whereas normally on a PC board, they'd be broken out, correct?
You would have a, well, I wouldn't say sound card, but you used to have those. But you were in the old days, you'd have a sound card.
Did I date myself again?
A sound blaster?
You'd have a sound blaster. Well, you'd put your sound blaster in your 3DFX card. And, but no, you'd have these discrete components is what you call it, right?
Yeah.
Discrete components that do all these things. In the Scorpio engine and in modern consoles, they're all in one place,
right?
And we call that the Scorpio engine.
Got it. So that's what. So let's continue on with, you know, what he saw. And Jeff, you seem to have a question.
Well, yeah. So we talked about 6 teraflops. I saw way more numbers come out in so 6 teraflops tells us something about just like raw power, but I think we're getting sort of a better idea of what that can now translate into.
Yeah, I mean, there are so many. Numbers. and each of them is important to do different things. And I wish I could just come up with a great analogy, you know, about a car or something, which that's where I tend to go. But, you know, you generally think of the GPU is about rendering the pixels on the screen, and the CPU is about AI and frame rate.
Moving those bits and pixels.
Moving
around.
Those. And the amount of memory you have is how much graphics quality can be stored. I'm really oversimplifying. I'll get slaughtered for describing it this way.
Yeah.
And so all of these things need to work together.
Mm-hmm.
You need to have enough GPU to be able to drive, you know, 8 million pixels or whatever is on a 4K TV.
Right.
You need enough CPU to feed that GPU fast enough so that your frame rates and your AI and all of that. And by the way, things like load times are bound by your CPU as well.
Right.
And then you need enough memory to store all those textures and all that information.
Yeah.
And so the reason you see a lot of numbers is to sort of describe, we've got 6 teraflops of GPU. That's about driving a 4K display.
Yep.
We have, we got to 2.3 gigahertz on our CPU, which is crazy. You know, both of these are crazy fast for the technology, but we made a ton of improvements like moving DX12 out of the CPU and into the GPU.
There's been a lot of people were talking about that, and they're like, wait a minute, how do I get that?
Yeah, well, it's about freeing up resources. So you take commands that you have to write in code and you embed them in the hardware, and then that frees the CPU to do other things. And then I have to have memory bandwidth. That's how fast the information in memory can feed the CPU and GPU. So all these things have to work together.
I guess to phrase it a little bit better, when you mentioned like 6 teraflops, that talks about, you know, that's the GPU, but Scorpio is more than just about improved visuals, 4K visuals, correct?
Well, that's the thing about it. We had a goal, and the goal was to own 4K, to be able to drive true 4K games.
And we kind of started that. I'm sorry, with Xbox One S, because it's the only console with a 4K Blu-ray player.
Yeah, we're committed. With HDR and 4K Blu-ray on Xbox One S, we're like committed to 4K. Like, we love 4K.
And there is a 4K drive in Scorpio. We saw, right?
We've confirmed that with Project Scorpio.
Yep.
And so we needed all these things to work together to be able to drive 4K. But that wasn't the only goal. So developers can decide what to do with this power. They don't have to build 4K games if they don't want to. That's right. One thing. They can go, we're just giving them an unbelievable amount of horsepower to realize their visions. I always say we have to have a goal.
Mm-hmm.
Our goal was 4K.
Mm-hmm.
But the developers are going to choose their own path, and that's awesome. Mm. The other benefit is it just elevates the Xbox platform in general. It brings a ton of improvements to the library that you already own.
Yeah. And I think that's really important, because when we talk about Xbox, we talked about Xbox One and Xbox One S and now Scorpio. That is the family of devices.
That's right.
And what does that mean, Albert?
Well, there's a lot of analogies. And so I'll use two, and both of them break in their own way, but there's the analogy to the phone and there's the analogy to the PC.
Okay.
And when we started Scorpio, the idea was, this is the way things work today. People upgrade their devices more frequently, and they expect that
their tablets, their phones,
PCs. And they expect that content just goes with them. And oh, by the way, when I get the new iPhone or the new iPad, my old stuff is faster.
Yeah, it works. Looks great.
And by the way, people then make, you know, improvements to those things that work on that
phone. Those apps, right.
Or there's the PC, which is game engines today are just inherently scalable. They have to work on game consoles. They have to work on low-end PCs and high-end PCs.
Mm-hmm.
And I can, the nice thing about PC is I can buy as much performance as I can afford.
Mm-hmm.
And so neither one of those models are exactly what we're doing, but there's ideas in both. And
sure.
So when I talk about the family, I guess the closest would be a PC, in that you could think of the Xbox One S as a great gaming PC.
Yep.
And you could think about Scorpio as a really badass gaming PC.
Right.
I don't get to play a PC game because I chose one of the two. The settings might have to come down. I can only run it at 1080 instead of running in 4K.
Sure.
I have to turn some effects off, or maybe the textures aren't quite as good.
Right.
But it's the same game.
It's the same game.
And that's the model that we're using with Scorpio, is they are part of the same family. The game run on both, but we've designed Scorpio to be able to sort of literally turn the dial up to 11 on Xbox One games, if that's what's important to you.
So I just got a 4K TV, and my mind is currently still blown. I'm still just like walking around, like my pupils dilated and stuff like that.
Well, they're really going to blow your mind, because I didn't tell you this, Albert, but I let him borrow my copy of Planet Earth 2.
Oh, I'm going to watch that tonight.
Yeah, 4K.
Yeah.
I said, that's the one.
That is the one.
Yes. So I'll be doing that, but I'm still just amazed at the size and all, and just like the brightness and the resolution and everything. And I'm playing on Xbox One S. And the HDR,
that's great.
So there's that. But 2 days ago, I didn't have a 4K TV. And we know that as many people as are going to be adopting 4K in the next 5-6 years, for those that are still running 1080, what does Scorpio do for them?
Yeah, that I see that question a lot, and I think it's great. There's a lot. I'll talk about the one thing that's probably the least understood last, and
yeah.
I'll talk about the easier things first.
Go hard.
So when the first thing is, we have a hard drive in Scorpio that provides about 50% more throughput than the hard drive in the existing Xbox, and that's because we didn't want load times to be terrible when you're loading these big 4K textures.
Right, right.
So we did a lot of work on a custom hard drive in our console. The nice thing about that is when I'm loading 1080p textures, the load times are much faster. So just by putting an Xbox One game into Scorpio, your games are going to load faster.
Right.
Now, I think everybody knows today, load times vary from game to game.
Of course.
But all up, your load times are going to be a lot faster on Scorpio for the existing game.
Right.
The second thing is people might remember when we launched Xbox One S that we upped the GPU clock just a little bit for HDR.
Just a wee bit.
And those that follow Digital Foundry will have noticed that a couple of games that have either dynamic resolution or dynamic frame rates saw a little bit of a bump.
Yeah.
A couple of frames per second when running on the new box. That was one of our design goals with Scorpio, is that those games will also be able to take advantage of the power of Scorpio. So if you have games with dynamic resolution or dynamic frame rates, you're going to run at even better, higher resolution and higher frame rates. And in many cases, you should max out frame rate and resolution for an Xbox One game running on Scorpio.
Right.
So there's another great reason. There's some filtering improvements, some texture filtering improvements that are inherent in the hardware. I will be out of my element to try and describe what that means, but just assume that the texture quality and the anti-aliasing is a little bit better on Scorpio. This requires no work, by the way, on the developers.
Sure.
This is just inherent. The last one is something called super sampling. And that's the one that the guys that I think a lot of the enthusiasts are really excited about. And so again, I will give the way I would describe this to my wife.
Okay.
If you're a photographer and you've got a 20, what's the latest 20 megapixel camera? Like what is a SLR take?
20, let's say 20.
Okay. When you take a 20 megapixel picture, you've got 20 megapixels worth of information.
Yep.
Your phone screen is not 20 megapixels.
Right.
But all the data is there.
Right.
So 20 megapixel pictures on a phone screen look great. Mm-hmm. When you shrink them down, none of the information is lost.
Right.
So you kind of think of super sampling as the same thing. It's a way that all the 4K improvements that exist in Scorpio games, that information is still there, even on your 1080p screen.
Okay.
So the better textures, the better anti-aliasing, all that information is there.
Right.
And then we do work in hardware to shrink it down to 1080p. So you basically get all of the 4K quality, but you're just on a 1080p display.
Sure.
Just like you can see a 10 megapixel picture on your phone, but your phone isn't 10 megapixels.
Got it.
So that's probably the best way I can describe it. What it means is anti-aliasing, just the quality of the art, all the graphics improvements that they're doing for the 4K games, you'll still see it.
Right.
You just won't get the native resolution.
Right. Okay, my head's kind of blowing.
Yeah, no, right. That was a good explanation.
Thank you very much for that.
Yeah.
Because one of the questions we also see is, well, wait a minute, so should I buy an Xbox One S now, or should I wait for Project Scorpio later this year? What are you telling people about that decision? Because it's key, it's important to know, is that you're and Phil said this last year on stage, your games go with you.
That's right. I mean, the fact is that people who own an Xbox One right now own Scorpio games.
Right.
They have games that will be better on Scorpio.
Yep.
Their accessories work on Scorpio.
Yep.
Their, you know, whatever you've got, your friends list, your achievements, right, your gamer score. All that investment you've made in Xbox One, is you're already a Scorpio owner.
Right.
In many ways.
So in some ways, this holiday, when some of these listeners and many people hopefully will buy Scorpio, when they get it home, they just can unplug their USB drive and plug it back in, and they're off to the races.
Oh, I love to tell that story. I mean, right? This was one of my favorite, you know, the things that go easy and the things you debate about at work, always fun.
Yeah.
One of the biggest discussions that I had to have with the hardware team was actually about the power supply.
Right.
So we wanted the same, you know, the power output of Scorpio, and I mean by watts.
Yeah.
Like, you know, like
gigawatts,
200 and something watts of power,
right?
Requires typically, you know, heavier duty cable. You think about how big a cable is in a PC. I wanted the same cable, so literally every port,
right,
is the same. And look, we achieved it. We did it, but it was actually a lot of work.
It was hard,
and it was a big discussion,
right?
Because I wanted people who own an Xbox One S, if they choose to upgrade, all you do is you set the new box on top. You don't even have to look. Power supply, HDMI. Take the old one out, done.
Right.
You're good. Plug your hard drive in.
Yep.
It's your box again.
Right.
And like, that's a level of thoughtfulness we put into the design that actually seems like of course they would do that. But, you know, it was a lot of work.
It's one thing to design and in your head go, wouldn't it be nice if, but once you bring electrical engineers into the room, they put the pedal to the metal and they bring real facts.
Yeah, exactly.
Right? Sometimes things can't happen.
That's right. There's all kinds of, there, you know, there's a big world you ship products in with varying rules and regulations.
Right.
That sometimes put a dampener on your party sometimes. But look, they knocked it out of the park.
Yeah. Yeah. So the Digital Foundry, and again, Jeff, I'll put links in the
yeah, everything's in the
show notes. There's so much that Richard went over. Mm-hmm. Were you surprised that, like, he must have been like a sponge just absorbing everything?
It was interesting because, you know, again, I'll just use the sort of, we made a movie and we're sort of, you brought a reviewer in to see it and right off the bat. It's funny. The truth is he actually said very little. I think you're right. I think he was absorbing a tremendous amount of information that was coming at him.
Right.
And, you know, we didn't know, you know, I mean, obviously I think he, enjoyed getting to see things and enjoyed, getting to be able to talk to people and ask questions directly.
Right.
But you know, he leaves and then you don't know.
Now also, we want to point out that, you know, everything that's over there, it's everything that he wrote about. I mean, that's accurate, right?
That's what we did. I mean, we gave him the facts. We gave him the specs. We gave him the tech.
Yeah.
We let him ask questions of our engineers. Yeah. And then it's up to him to report on his on his findings.
Lots of good stuff. Do you have anything else you want to add before we move on? Because I mean, there's so much to go over.
You know what? Here's, I mean, again, I'm just really, obviously I'm tired.
Yeah, you are.
It's because it's been a long and exciting day. I'm so jazzed about what we're doing. I'm so jazzed about being able to talk to people about it. There's more coming. I mean, you know, this is not the end of our unveils of Scorpio.
Yeah,
it's actually the beginning, really, of our unveils around Scorpio. So I'm just, you know, I can't wait for the holidays.
The last time we had you on, though, you were talking about 4K TVs. I think it was before the holiday, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And so I wanted to see if you can kind of give us the 2017 Albert pitch on 4K TVs that you've been tracking. Jeff said he picked up one. What are you seeing in that? I mean, we're seeing momentum in that area, obviously.
Yeah, I mean, I if you look at the industry numbers, the rate of 4K TV sales versus 1080 sales is going to go through the roof.
Of course.
And I think probably by next year, most people, if you're buying a TV, will be buying a 4K TV.
Yeah.
Still, people don't buy TVs once a year like they do phones, so it takes a few years for that technology to adopt. I think right now the sets that are coming right now are really good.
Yeah.
I think actually this year's sets,
2017,
are probably the first time I would say I wouldn't be afraid of buying a TV.
Right.
Of course, the sizes go up, costs come down, features get added. You could just decide you never will buy a TV because the next year's one.
This is always
bigger. But if I think about, like, you know, these things are really, you know, really driving 4K pixels, really delivering HDR, really getting the latency down in game mode. This is a good year. Like, I think you're safe. And you know, as Jeff talked about, Jeff bought a very nice TV. That, you know, even in the mid-range sets, they're great. If you want to spend money on an OLED, those things are excellent. But you can get a really great 4K TV, I think, at a really reasonable price.
I just saw a question here online about Project Scorpio, just to get back to that, because we're just all over the place. When one thing we didn't show, we didn't show the visual, we didn't show the box. I mean, we kind of did because we see what's in the box. But what's going on there?
Well, one of my favorite ahead.
What's in the box?
What's in the box? Oh, come on. Actually, one of my favorite parts of the day, I'll tell this story. One of my favorite parts of the day was when we talked about the hardware.
Right.
So not the silicon and not the specs, but the actual box itself. And as it turns out, to productize this level of performance, I mean, think about how big a 4K capable PC
card
is.
It's a big boy.
Right? It's a big card.
Yeah.
And we're trying to squeeze that into something that fits under your television.
Right.
And so there is so much innovation and work put into the hardware. And so there was three things people probably heard us talk about. They heard us talk about the Hovis method, the vapor chamber.
Explain the Hovis method. I want to talk about those two things.
So I'll get into that. So Leo Del Castillo, who runs all of our hardware, he's actually run hardware since the original Xbox. He's built every Xbox.
Yeah, yes.
He actually brought all the pieces out on a table.
Okay.
And literally assembled it.
It was disemboweled
in real time.
Oh, wow.
It was just a cage.
Oh,
and he put it together in real time
as
he was describing it. And I think Richard mentions that in the article. And really, the craftsmanship into being able to do that, to just literally put it together and show how things like we have to keep the hard drive cable secure and away from the ODD drive because the minor vibrations from the Blu-ray drive can affect the signal quality between the hard drive and the motherboard.
So let's be clear, this is not just putting components on a box. This is looking at every cable and every electron that's going around there and making sure it's optimized and won't run into problems.
I'm thinking, like, it's not just Tetris spatially, but in the way they actually...
It's Tetris atomically.
That'll be a whole nother, like, the amount of density of this box. So there was a couple of things that we talked about, like, in order to power the Scorpio engine and cool the Scorpio engine, what were the things that we needed to do? Vapor chambers are things that, basically, it's a liquid cooling solution. And really, if you go look, only the highest end PC cards have vapor chambers.
And what is a vapor chamber?
It's effectively a heat sink on top of a membrane that is filled with water.
Okay.
And just like a radiator in your car, as it heats up, it turns to vapor, and then that vapor then is quicker to be cooled through through the cooling.
Standard physics apply.
As opposed to just typically on a PC where you've just got the heat sink right on top of the chip.
Right.
So we have a liquid cooling.
He seemed
solution.
To like that idea.
It is, well, because he knows that's the kind of tech that's reserved for really high end graphics cards.
Right.
And we've got it in a console, and is, you know, no other console has ever had a vapor chamber in it.
Right.
The centrifugal fan, you know, we use an axial fan today.
Okay. What does that mean?
So think of one as, one is like a squirrel cage. So one is a blower and one, I gotta think about how to describe this.
I found a
it's a difference between a fan. It's a difference between a fan that you have in your house,
right,
and a fan for like a HVAC system. So like a regular fan is an axial fan. It just blows air.
Okay.
This takes air and compresses
okay.
it.
Okay. So we see them as circles. Looks like
So an axial fan would be like a typical PC fan that you see that just looks like fan blades.
And if you look at some of the graphics we released, you can probably see the actual fan case right in the middle there.
The actual cage for the centrifugal fan.
Okay.
So basically what it does is it produces a much higher volume of air and cooling at a much lower fan speed.
Sure.
So that's how we're able to cool the box and not have it be loud.
Right.
So we moved to a centrifugal fan for Scorpio. The last thing, one of my favorite things, is the Hovis method. So this is something that our team invented.
Who is this Hovis?
There's really a guy, and I won't. There's really a guy whose last name is Hovis who works on the team.
Okay.
Who basically came up with this method, for basically fine tuning the power. That each and every unique Scorpio is shipped with. So anybody who overclocks their GPUs and stuff and PCs kind of understands that you play with the voltages and you can run your CPU at different voltages and sometimes you'll get a little bit more power. Sometimes you can lower the voltage and get the same performance. So there's a distribution curve.
And this all lends to the fact that when those integrated circuit chips are coming off of the assembly line, there's a margin of error.
There's a margin of error.
Right.
They all perform.
Some
require
spec.
A little bit more power, and we're talking about like little tiny amounts of power,
right?
To achieve the performance goals. Well, you actually waste power by just because you have to obviously power every chip to the needs of
right. So you're like, this is what we're going to power this at X.
That's not how it works in Scorpio. Every single chip is running at the power necessary to power that particular chip.
So it's dynamic.
So it's dynamic to each console. It's more energy efficient. So we don't waste any energy in the box. And it's one of the things that allows us, to keep it cool because we are only running the voltages required.
So hopefully no electricity is being wasted.
We are not wasting any electricity in the box,
man. I have a new life goal, and that is to get a method named after me. I want the Rubenstein method.
Well, there's a sandwich named after you. That's all you get.
Not even the best Reuben. You know?
Not even the best Reuben. So no, I jokingly call it the supercharged, intercooled, and dyno-tuned.
Okay.
So
your car terms
right,
again.
There's my car terms. We've got a supercharger in the fan.
Yep.
We've got an intercooler in the vapor chamber, and we dyno-tune each and every chip to make sure it's running optimally at the factory, each and every unit.
That's crazy. I mean, I don't even know what to say because I remember when you were explaining. I've been aware of the teams, what we've been working on for many years because you and I talk all the time. But every time I would stop by and see you, I remember you just get up on the whiteboard and you'd pencil it out, and I was like, this is amazing. So to see it all come to fruition in this really concrete way is really extraordinary.
It is. The team is. You know, I think that we had clear goals.
Yep.
The team is just operating like it has just been such a fun and sort of inclusive, just like brainstorming and arguing.
Kind of reminds me of
doing all the great stuff you want to do.
Reminds me of when we were working on 360, doesn't it?
It does. It has. There's a lot of that vibe. There's a lot of that energy right now.
Yeah.
It's like this is going to be an excellent product.
Yeah.
We got a lot more good news.
Yeah.
I think for people, and we built the most powerful console ever.
Yeah.
And today we told everybody, and we proved it.
And over the coming months, and obviously leading up to launch, we'll have more news. Games, of course. That's going to be the theme.
That's
going
to be the big one. Games. Look, I get it. I hear the feedback. I want everybody to know games.
Yeah, but what about the games, Albert?
It's coming. Today was about the specs. Today we told you what the box does.
Yeah.
you're going to see games we know.
What's interesting is there's this shim in between the great games that are coming and the hardware that we talked about. And that you talked about a little bit earlier about the developer platform. And yeah. we have this whole interesting developer story as well that probably is going to be coming out in the future, right?
Yeah, I think one of the things I'll just sort of tease is, like, I think one of the things that people wonder about this transition to the two console model is, am I going to get two slightly less versions of the game
right.
than I would have gotten, you know, in the old model where I can just work on one platform for 10 years.
Right.
We have put as much care and craftsmanship and effort and energy into the process for developers as we've put into the product for customers.
Yeah.
And that's a story that I'm excited to, you know, to be able to tell at some
point.
Which,
and just to put a fine point on it, and that means more games.
That means better. It means better games.
Better, more
because
games.
The developers are spending time on the content and the quality, and not spending time making things work.
Right, right, right. Which is critical.
Yeah.
Fun. Jeffrey, you had something to say?
No, I'm excited. I'm ready. I'm glad I bought my
yeah,
new TV.
That's right. Get your 4K TVs now, kids.
All right, Jeff. Thank you, Albert. Albert's going to hang out with us a little bit, but we're going to want to tick through some of the headlines before we get going. Even though, you know, everything almost pales in comparison.
It kind of does, yeah. But there, you know what? There's still new things to play this week.
Yeah,
including the April update for Gears of War 4. So yeah. That's going to include some chocolate weapons. Remember back at PAX
yes.
in Boston where you were hefting a 39-pound chocolate lancer?
Team Creamy. Let's be clear.
I asked
for peanut butter, and the text I got from
yes,
Blaine was,
right. Okay.
It was crunchy or creamy.
You can't just say things like that out of context.
Okay.
But yes, we did have creamy peanut butter. There. Okay. Yeah, okay. So now that we've said that, I think we should just abandon it. But oh, yes, there are some new weapons, new maps. Obviously, the Gears team up in Vancouver continuing to support Gears of War 4, and the new maps coming will be Hotel and The Slab. Also, Dead Rising 4 has a major piece of DLC, which really like a couple of new game modes. Really, one is a mini golf mode.
Yeah.
And the other one is called Frank Rising. I'll link to a trailer for that. But Frank has been infected, and now you're actually a zombie, and
yeah.
So it sort of turns the gameplay on its head. A couple new releases I want to call out this week. One is an Xbox Play Anywhere game.
Yes.
We know what that means. You buy it on Xbox, you can play it on Windows 10.
And?
Vice versa, you buy it on Windows 10.
You also be able to play it on your Scorpio later this year.
Yes, yes, exactly. So this one's an indie darling. It's called Enter the Gungeon.
Mm-hmm.
And so I know personally I'm going to be jumping into this, but it's a very fast-paced dungeon crawler shooter type of game. So you can definitely check that one out. And like all XPA games, you buy it once, you play it anywhere, and your save games, achievements, everything will go with you.
Yes.
Big release this week, Lego City Undercover.
Dun, 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 dun.
Yes. So,
Albert, you like the Lego games.
I love Legos.
Yeah, I know you. I know you do.
So, like all Lego games, two-player co-op, which is always the best way to play through those. And then, want to call an ID at Xbox game, Use Your Words. So, I know you've played Drawful.
Yeah.
You've played the Jackbox Party
Pack. The Jackbox
pack.
Games, yeah.
And one of the best parts about that is when you're playing with folks who aren't gamers, they just use their phone. It doesn't matter what kind of
phone
you have.
Any device, yeah, just use your device.
Then you can go ahead and you can play along with, and this is another one of those games. So great
use
party game for
words.
People if you don't have enough controllers, or people that aren't gamers and are intimidated by a controller.
Yes, controllers are scary.
For some people. And this mm-hmm. can, not no one in this room, but they can play along with you and be just as good. So that's called Use Your Words. And if you're looking for a party game this weekend, worth checking out.
All right. What else? Did you go over the Duke Nukem news?
It was Duke Nukem news?
Well, didn't you see this week on Xbox on Friday? With me dressed as Duke Nukem?
You sent me a picture with no context earlier in the week, much like Team Creamy, that gave me pause.
Albert, did you see, so this week on Xbox, if you don't know, it airs on your console every week, and I did a bit this week. Where is it? I've got it right here. Here, show that to Albert, here.
Is this Mr., do I call you Mr. Nukem?
Well, this is a little, I'll let you kind of figure
Major
that part.
Nukem?
This was in front of the green screen, and I'll let you figure that one out. But yeah, go ahead and just turn on your Xbox.
Two tickets to the gun show. Yeah, that's
right. Bring yeah. in the guns.
That's right.
Or I call them the pistols.
Thank you very much. More of a war. More yeah. of a, all right already. Maybe enough. Hey, I don't see any of you guys in a tank top in front of 5 million people on the console.
It takes Moxie.
Yeah. Yes. Anyway, so that's. But all the details you can find this news, much more over my blog at majornelson.com, and this week on Xbox, which airs every Friday. Right on your console.
And this would, I'm assuming, be how to use Duke Nukem in Bulletstorm, full clip edition?
That's right.
All right.
That's right. So, great game. Remember that game?
I do remember that game.
That was so good. What are you playing right now, Albert, other than the Scorpio game?
I haven't had time to do anything.
I know you haven't.
I have not had time.
I know.
I like games. I remember when I had time to play games.
Do you?
Yeah. This feels like
Did you get anything good lately?
Did I get anything good
lately? Usually you find those good old school games that you're kind of collecting.
I did finally get my NES Classic, which I'm very excited about.
With a really tiny cord?
No, I bought the extender. Yeah, I bought the extender, and then I got the wireless ones. I like that thing a lot, actually.
What are you playing on it?
I went back and played a little Super Mario 3. And Punch-Out. I love the original Punch-Out. So
okay.
I love that thing. It's great. They did a great job on that.
All right.
Punch-Out, the first rhythm game. Once I started thinking about it like that, I realized, I'm not so intimidated.
By the way, only time that I owned a Punch-Out arcade game for a while, and I was terrible at it when I was a kid, but once I played the NES version, I was able to go back, and I got pretty good at the arcade game after playing the NES game, which they're so different, you wouldn't think that's true,
right.
But the rhythm is in the arcade game, too, so there you go. Yeah, I love Punch-Out.
Love it.
Nice.
Have you got a chance to check out Zelda yet?
Yeah, I bought my Switch. I got my Switch pre-order.
Zelda's good.
Also a fan. That thing's really super cool.
Yeah, Zelda's amazing.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
We talked about that on the last show, too. Lots of fun there. Anyway, all right. I think we're going to let Albert go because you need to kind of relax. You've had a busy. I really appreciate you coming by the studio and kind of giving us the lowdown on explaining it to us in simple terms for me, what all of it means. But at the end of the day, what it really means is great games for you, people.
Great games. Thanks, guys, for having me. I really appreciate it.
So if you can find Albert Pinello at Albert Pinello on Twitter. I'll put a link in the show notes. Thank you, Albert. Jeff, you can find Jeff at
Jeff Rubenstein.
My name is Larry here of Xbox Live's Major Nelson. We may not be here next week because I know I'm on the road. Jeff, you're on the road,
yes,
too.
Yes, sir.
So if Laura wants to do a show, I'll leave her the keys to the studio. Till then, see you guys later. Bye-bye, everybody.